purpose of this course is to give an introduction to first-order categorical logic with the aim of explaining the crucial notion of classifying topos of a geometric theory, and especially the way classifying toposes can be used for discovering connections between different mathematical theories, much as in the spirit as that Grothendieck had in mind, toposes as unifying spaces, so toposes as tools that could be used for connecting different mathematical theories with each other and transferring results, notions, and properties across them. So why is logic important in connection with such a unifying project? Well, because logic allows to formalize the notion of mathematical theory, and so the comparison between the different mathematical theories becomes something that can be carried out in a most rigorous way. Now, classifying toposes provide even more than just logic, because as we shall see, the notion of classifying topos really formalizes the notion of content of a mathematical theory. So, and this is particularly important in connection with the goal of unifying different theories, because if you discover that two theories have the same classifying topos, basically this means that the two theories tell the same story in different languages. And so this can be something very interesting, very useful potentially, both conceptually and technically, because every time you have multiple points of view on a given situation, you can switch from one to another according to the features of the problem that you want to investigate. And this usually is something very, very useful. Okay, so I will start with by recalling the basics of first-order categorical logic, starting from the notion of the first-order language. Okay, so what is a first-order language? Well, these are the languages that are most studied in logic. They admit a very nice model theory, and thanks to classifying toposes, also a functorial model theory, in the sense that models can be thought of as functors, preserving a certain kind of structure. But these are a wide class of languages that can be used for describing mathematical structures. Now, the basic point of logic is really to make a separation between two different levels: the level of syntax and the level of semantics. So the idea is that the semantics are just the mathematical structures that one wants to investigate. So, for instance, varieties, groups, whatever. Usually mathematicians work from a logical point of view with the semantics. The syntax is the word of languages, of ways that we may use for describing these structures. So, of course, you are familiar with the fact that, in general, you can describe a certain thing in many different ways. So, in logic, it's the same thing. So, you can have many different syntaxes, in some sense, for a given semantic content. And logic is all about the relationship between these two levels. So, it's very important to bear in mind that logic is all about a duality, basically. It's about a duality between the structures and the way we can describe them. And now, more technically, first-order languages are languages which consist of three different kinds of entities, sorts, terms, and formulas. Now, I should, first of all, clarify why there is this restriction first order. Well, this simply means that in the axioms of a first order theory, you are only allowed to quantify over individuals of your structures and not over collections of individuals or collections of individuals. So, for instance, the commutativity property that you have in a ring, this is you can formalize in a first order way, but for instance, if you want to describe the property of the real numbers that every bounded subset is a supremum, It is a second order if you want to formalize the real numbers as a set of elements, because you have to refer to collections of such elements. Okay, so this is the basic restrictions that one makes in order to have a well-behaved model theory. In logic, people have also investigated higher-order logics, but also if we want to investigate Grothendieck toposes from a logical point of view, we will always remain at the first-order level, even though we shall use sites also. And the notion of site that is fundamental for defining toposes. Basically, you can define a Grothendieck topos as any category which is equivalent to the category of sheaves on a site. So Professor Cartier talked about the sheaves on a topological space, but actually the general notion of topos is this, sheaves on a site. And this generalization from locales, let's say, because one cannot say that toposes strictly generalize topological spaces, they strictly generalize locales, like open sets. So this generalization is actually very, very, very powerful, because here you are still in the context of topology, while here it is the place where you can realize the marriage between the continuous and the discrete, as Grothendieck was saying. Because on one hand, so these sheaves are defined in a completely formal way, formally analogous way as you define sheaves on a topological space. But the resulting level of generality is incomparably broader, because this encompasses at the same time this. And the three sheaf categories that Joyal talked about in his course. So this you can see, if you want, as continuous. And this is great. In fact, here, to get just three sheaves, you take the trigger Grothendieck topology. And while here, the Grothendieck topology is by no means trivial, because it is given by the... the usual covering relation that you have in topology. And so, I mean, you can present Grothendieck toposes as classifying toposes of theories axiomatized in first-order logic, but you can also present them through sites. And the notion of site is actually a second-order notion, because a site consists in a small category, C, whatever category, not just Cartesian, what is called a Grothendieck topology on it. I will just briefly review what it is. A Grothendieck topology is a way to assign to each object of the category a collection of sieves from C. What is a sieve? Well, it is just a collection of arrows with a codomain C, which is closed under composition on the right. So if I have an arrow in the sieve, then I want its composite with whatever arrow also in the sieve. But this is because it is useful when you want to define sheaves. Of course, it is completely innocuous, because if you have a collection of arrows in the same codomain, you can always close it up like that. You take all the arrows that factors through at least one of the arrows in the family. Okay, so you have an assignment that sends to each object of C a collection of sieves. So these are called the J-covering sieves, and writes S belongs to J of C to indicate that a sieve is a J-covering, that it belongs to the topology. And of course, one has to require some properties which correspond to the properties of universal closure operators that Joyal alluded to in his talk. These are just three properties: the maximality condition, which means that the maximal sieve on each object should be covering. So first is maximality. Second is the pullback stability. So this simply means that if you have a sieve which is covering, then any pullback of this sieve along an arbitrary arrow should also be covering. And then you have a third condition, which is what is called the transitivity. this you can formulate it in this way. Imagine that you have many sieves that are covering, and that you can multi-compose them. Well, you want that the result is also covering. Okay, so you see these are very natural conditions that one can put, and this is what a Grothendieck topology is. And you see here that it is a second order notion, because you take a collection of sieves, and the sieve is a collection of arrows. So you see it is second order because you both talk about objects and arrows, and you also talk about collections of arrows. So this is a second order notion, and it is useful for studying second order notions through toposes, such as the notion of topological space itself. This was just a digression from the main line, because now I want to talk about first-order languages. Now, first-order languages consist, as I have written, into three basic ingredients: sorts, terms, and formulas. Now, sorts are things that are meant to specify the kinds of individuals, the kinds of elements you want to talk about. For instance, imagine that you want to formalize the notion of category. Then, when you present the notion of category, what do you say? You say, we have a collection of objects and a collection of arrows. Of course, if you want, you can avoid talking about objects, because you can identify them with the identity arrows on them, but it doesn't matter. You still want, it is natural to talk about objects and arrows to distinguish them. And so, for instance, you could choose two sorts, one for objects and one for arrows, to formalize this notion. So sorts are meant to represent kinds, let's say, kinds of individuals. Terms are meant to represent individuals themselves. And formulas are meant to make assertions about these individuals.
Where do you put operations, for instance?
Well, operations is when you build the formulae, you start with some basic formulas, which are called atomic formulae, and then from those, you build more complicated formulas by using all these logical operators, which are...
I didn't mean that. I mean, what I meant is that, okay, when you say kind of individuals and all that, do you consider, for instance, that the product is part of that? For instance, if I define, a group.
Yes. So then you have just one sort in that case.
You have one sort?
Yes.
Where is the product?
The product is, it's a term. Basically, a product, you have an operation. But I will give the precise definition. This is just the basic idea, but I will give the precise definition later. Formally, it is an operation. It is a function symbol. The product is a function symbol, and starting from function symbols, you can formulate the terms, because the terms are just what you obtain starting from variables or constants by applying function symbols to them a finite number of times. So, for instance, in the theory of groups, you will have a binary operation. You can say like this. So just one sort, one binary operation. And, of course, you can consider, this is really...
But the binary operation is a sort.
No. The sort is one. You just want one set. Take the classical set theoretic foundation. You just want... when you consider... Normally, one doesn't need to have many sorts. The reason why I am presenting this in full generality is that when you talk about the internal language of a topos, then actually the natural thing to do is to take one sort for each object. So for groups, you have one sort. Just one sort. Then you have a binary operation, which is the multiplication, say, if you think of a multiplicative group.
What a binary operation, it's a term?
No. This is a function symbol. I will define.
So you start. You have another thing.
But I will give the definition in the formal definition, as I have said. I'm giving the formal definition later. This was just the idea of the language. So then, starting from then, you can consider, of course, this is another way of writing like that. And of course, you can carry on this. You can multiply also with another thing, z, for instance, and go on like that. And all of these are terms, and as you can see, these denote individuals, because X and Y are individuals, and if I apply functional symbols to them, I still am inside the individuals. While for formulas...
The rule is that I no longer think of them as elements of a set.
No, you can think of them as generalized elements. When you work in categorical semantics, you should replace elements with generalized elements. Anyway, this was just meant to be, the general philosophy, but now I will give the precise definition. Now, formal languages, you can always interpret them in the classical set theoretic foundation. And this is known at least since Tarski. But what I'm going to tell you today is categorical semantics, which is the interpretation of first-order languages in categories possessing enough categorical structure for one to be able to meaningfully interpret all the connectives and quantifiers that one wants to talk about. formally, we have to define the notion of first-order signature.
So your first order theories are like in most books with finitary, only finitary operations, but throughout the course of Laforgerie,
yeah,
he spoke about things with infinite...
Of course. So when you talk about the first order, you can also take infinitary disjunctions or infinitary conjunctions. I will specify exactly the fragment of logic that we are going to investigate because of its link with Grothendieck toposes, which is called the geometric logic. In geometric logic, when you form your formulas, which are called the geometric formulas, you are allowed to use finitary conjunctions, infinitary disjunctions, and existential quantification. And the axioms of a geometric theory, as we shall see, they are all of this form. Phi entails y in a given context. A context is a list of distinct variables which contains all the variables of these formulas. And you require this to be geometric. Geometric means that they are built from atomic formulas by only using this, this, and this. And here you don't have any bound on the cardinality. The only thing that you need is a set, just a set. So it is an infinitary logic, if you want.
But do you allow, like in most places, to have propositional things, and usually they have both quantifiers exist and for every, and also you can...
No, at the point, the number of free variables should always remain finite. The number of free variables. I mean, in principle, you could, when you use an infinitary disjunction like that, you might a priori end up with an infinite number of free variables. You don't want that. You don't want that. Geometrically, you can understand it immediately, because if you allow this, then the interpretation will be a subobject of an infinite product. And infinite products are not necessarily preserved by inverse images of geometric morphisms. So you need to impose this condition. But I will come to that. So what is a first-order signature? Well, we have... a set of, we use this, signature is a synonym of language. I mean, it's a third technical term for that, used by logicians. A first order signature consists into three sets, set of sorts that are usually denoted with these capital letters, like that. Then a set of function symbols, and each function symbol is... equipped with entrance sorts and output sorts. I mean, normally we require a finite list of input sorts and just one output sort for each function symbol. And then we have a relation symbol. Relation symbols as well are equipped with an indication of the sorts on which they act. So to come back to the situation of groups, in groups you have one sort and you have one constant. A constant can be treated as zero array function symbols. Where here if you take n equals zero, then you get a constant, what is called a constant.
So for groups, you have a binary function symbol. So here, of course, I can repeat the same sort, right? So I don't need this A1, AN to be distinct, so I will have my binary operation. One sort and no relation symbols, because I don't need, in the case of groups, more generally, when you want to formalize... when you study structures that are formalized in universal algebra sense, then the axioms of your theory will be of this kind: equalities between terms. And so you will not need associativity, and these are all of this kind. Yes, if you want, you can do that. Yes. Yes, because otherwise you have to use an existential quantification, and there are various ways to do this, but yes, it's natural to introduce a unary operation to formalize the inverse. Okay. Yeah, of course, if you want to formalize the notion of preordered set, so what is a preordered set? It's just a set with an order relation. And in this case, you see, it is not a function. Because, you see, here I am talking at a completely syntactic level, so everything I am saying here does not make any sense yet. It will make sense later, of course, otherwise. But for the moment, it is completely formal. But one should already keep in mind, this is why I put the first, I wrote on the first blackboard, the intended interpretation. Because the intended interpretation of function symbols are functions or arrows. So you see here, you don't have a function, you have a subset. This is a subset of the product of X with itself. And so this can be formalized with a relation symbol. Now, starting from all of this, what you do is, first of all, you build terms. And terms, I have already said how you do. You start with either, so you suppose that for each sort, you have an infinite stock of variables. Normally, to indicate that a variable has a sort A, you write like that. And starting from these variables, always a finite number of times, a finite number of them, you build terms inductively, applying function symbols to them, and so on. I don't think I have to write formally, because it's very clear. Okay, now... formulas. When I define formulas, I come to that. So formulas. So first of all, as I said at the beginning, formulas are meant to make assertions about individuals, and individuals are meant to be represented by terms. So formulas, the simplest formulas that you can think of this kind. You can either have an equality between two terms of the appropriate sorts, because of course it doesn't make sense if the two terms don't have the same sort. It doesn't make sense to write something like that. So of course you require them to have the same sort, and you can for sure consider this kind of... Yeah, please? Yes, of course. This is because I didn't give the formal definition, but of course, since function symbols come always equipped with sorts, and terms are built just inductively, starting from function symbols, they will also be equipped with a sort, automatically. Yeah, I mean, the variables are always all equipped with a sort themselves, by definition. You have infinitely many. No, it's not, because normally you don't need infinitely many, so I mean, you... yeah, I mean, this is a problem that you might encounter in the... Yeah, if you want, yeah. Okay, so the simplest kinds of formulas that you can consider are this. On one end, equalities between terms, and if you have relation symbols, you can also consider things of this kind. always provided that everything is composable, I mean that everything has the right sorts. Okay? So these are called atomic formulas. Okay, now, of course, you can see this as a particular case of that if you take R to be the equality relation, but of course, in all languages that we consider, the equality is always there, so we don't even treat it as formally as a relation symbol, but I mean, morally it is. Okay, so these are the simplest formulas that you can construct, and for this reason they are called atomic formulas. And now, to build the full first order logic, you can operate on these formulas to build more complicated formulas by using various things. So on one end you have the logical connectives, which are this, the AND, the OR, the implication, the negation. You might also want to have a false, formulas for false and formulas for true. This you can also see formally, I mean true you can see as an empty conjunction, and false you can see as an empty disjunction if you want, but I mean I just preferred to write them explicitly because they are very important, for example here you see. So you can either use this say operators, or you have the quantifiers that you can also use, the existential and the universal quantifier. And you can operate on, starting from these atomic formulas, you can build first order formulas by applying a finite number of times all of these things. As I have already mentioned, we also allow, I mean, when we speak of infinitary first order logic, we can allow also both infinitary conjunctions and infinitary disjunctions. We shall particularly need infinitary disjunctions when investigating geometric logic. So bear in mind that this is by no means restricted to be finitary, except that you have to, I mean, when you define formulas, you simultaneously define the free variables of these formulas. So you have to define the notion of free or bound variable. And this simply means, I mean, a variable in a certain formula is said to be free if it appears in the formula as not quantified. So, for instance, consider this formula and bound otherwise. So, you can consider this formula here. And you see that y is free in this formula, but not x. X is bound because you have that. Okay. So it's important to make this distinction because, as we said, in the case of infinitary conjunctions or disjunctions, a priori the number of free variables might be infinite, and instead we require. Yeah.
The terms are defined just compositions of functions.
Yes. Yes.
So inductive. Free opera.
Yeah.
Opera.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Okay, so now we know about free and bound variables, so we can define the notion of context for a formula. So a context for a formula is just context for a formula will be just a finite list of distinct variables which contain all the free variables of the formula, which contain. This is very important that you don't just take all the free variables of the formula, but you allow all the finite set of distinct variables which contain this. This is important for technical reasons, because if you had only to consider the minimal context, the theory would become much more cumbersome. So, for instance, in this situation, an appropriate context for this might be YZ. For instance, or YZ and W or something like that. Okay, how shall we present our theories? Well,
since we want to put certain restrictions on the kind of formulas to use, we use the sequent notation. So what is a sequent?
Well, a sequent is just a formal expression. Here, as I have said, no meaning yet. So take things just because we have not yet talked about the semantics.
So it is just a formal expression of this kind, where you have an antecedent and a conclusion. And these are formulas in the context, in the same context. Here I use the vectorial notation. This is supposed to be something like that. A finite list of distinct variables, like that. So in the same context, and the intended meaning of this expression is that, basically, if you are used to first order logic, it's just that. For all x, phi entails psi. So it means that for any values that you might attribute to the variables in this context, if these variables, these elements, let's say, satisfy phi, then they will also satisfy psi.
X.
I said y. No. The context.
Context.
Here. X. Okay.
But
yeah.
The context is always finite.
Yes. Yes. So by definition of context, yes. 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 Always finite.
But you can always enlarge it.
Yes, exactly, but just with the finite number of, Okay, because as we shall see, this is important because we shall always consider formulas in a given context and when talking about their interpretation, because of course the context will determine the interpretation. A formula in a given context X like that will be interpreted as a sub-object. So suppose that you have a structure M in which you can interpret everything, then the interpretation of this formula, this is the notation for the interpretation in M of this formula, will be a subobject of this Cartesian product. And so you see, this would be infinite if you allowed an infinite number of them.
What do you mean by M A1, the objects of type?
This will be the interpretation of the sorts in M. So each sort we shall define.
So M A1 is a subset of M?
No. It is just M. When you have a structure for a certain signature, you need to interpret each sort of that signature. And so M of A is just the interpretation of the sort A in the structure M. That's it. Okay, so this is the sequent notation that we use to formulate our theories. So what is a theory? Well, it is just a set of sequence. Here I work in a meta-theory in which I make a distinction between sets and proper classes, right? So set of sequence, and of course sequence within the given fragment of logic. Now, what is a fragment of logic? I mean, a fragment is just the choice of allowing only certain types of formulas and not other formulas. So now I shall define the various fragments that we shall use.
Theory, don't have signature sigma.
Yeah. Over a fixed signature. Okay, so let us define different fragments of logic. So as we had already mentioned, the notion of algebraic logic, so algebraic theories. So the axioms are of this form, just equalities between terms. Then we can consider regular theories. These are theories whose axioms can be presented like in this form, where one requires this to be regular. And what does it mean? Regular means obtained from atomic formulas by only using finitary conjunctions and existential quantification. Then we have the notion of coherent theory.
You mean no negation, for instance?
No. I will explain later why. negations in arbitrary, I mean, in the set-theoretic context, the negation is interpreted as the complement. The problem is that in an arbitrary topos, you don't have complements unless the topos is Boolean. And so the way you do is to use the pseudo-complement, the I-think pseudo-complement, but then this will not be a true complement. So you can interpret all the connectives that I have written there in a topos. You can do it. The problem is the preservation of their models by morphisms of toposes. Because in order for to add classifying toposes, what you want is to have representing objects for certain semantic functors. And in order to have these functors, in order just to be able to define these functors should send models of the theory in a certain category to models of the theory in another category. And if you allow the axioms of your theory to contain negations, and you use the notion of morphism given by Grothendieck, the notion of geometric morphism, then you have that you have to use these functors here, the inverse images of geometric morphisms. And these inverse images, as it has been said, they only preserve, in general, finite limits and arbitrary collimits. And they will not, in general, preserve pseudo-complements. And so you have to exclude these negations from the axioms. But this is not a big problem, because you can make a trick. You can, if you just are interested, for instance, in the set-based models of the theory, what you can do is you make this trick instead of doing this. So you know that you cannot talk about that. But then you can introduce a predicate, and then you can, which you can call the, say, N of this formula, and you can put some coherent axioms, some geometric axioms, which ensure that this is a real complement to your formula. And in this way, you end up with a geometric theory, and this is a process that in full generality is called the Morleyization of a geometric theory. And it is a very powerful means, because it allows to study any kind of finitary first order theory using classifying toposes through this construction. Of course, the models in an arbitrary topos will be different, because this will be the real complement. This will force, the model to contain a real complement, while in general this complement might not exist. So in a general topos, the models will be different, but in the topos of sets, they will be the same. And so, if you are just interested in classical model theory, you can live with that.
Are you saying that you consider only constructive ways to construct negation?
Geometric logic doesn't contain negation, so I'm not caring at all about negation, and here I'm just suggesting that what you can do if you want to treat a negation or a sort of negation using geometric logic. We are really forced to not to have negations because of this reason, unless we change the morphisms between the toposes that we want to consider. Nobody forces us to take geometric morphisms, but there are advantages for doing that. We could, because other kinds of morphisms would be less frequent also in mathematics, less frequently arising. You can consider, for instance, the notion of logical functor between two toposes. This is something that you can do, but there are very few of these functors. At least they are rarely arising in geometric situations. The reason why it's called geometric morphisms is that really it comes from geometry, because any continuous map of topological spaces or locales, more generally, gives rise to a geometric morphism between the associated toposes. So here you have the direct image, and here you have the inverse image. So this is really the notion of morphism between toposes that is natural to consider when you work with Grothendieck toposes, for many other reasons as well that we shall see. So, negations. Yes, of course, I will come to that.
Otherwise, of course.
Yeah, but I'm getting a bit slower because of all the questions, so sorry.
It also could explain in algebraic series, you have capital T, it's like true, yeah, and then rotated T, which I don't know what this means, and then, on the very right.
Yes?
What is
T? True. The true implies this. Because you necessarily have to put something here.
True.
You have to put something here.
Okay, yeah.
True implies. If I had to put false, this would be trivially true.
Yeah, because you wrote in place also like two different notations in place, like in atomic formulas.
No, this is false. The one on the, this is false, and then that one is true.
No, but in the middle you have.
In the middle.
Or implies
negation.
Not notation for in place, yeah.
The turnstile.
No, the turnstile is a different thing.
Well.
Is it the same? It's the same
as license. No. This is the sequent notation.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
This is just a sort of the idea of consequence. It's just sequent notation. Okay, I was writing. Coherent theories. Okay, so you can define the fragment of coherent logic. So in coherent logic, you are allowed axioms of this form. Here you require the two formulas to be coherent. Coherent means that, so here you only allow this, and coherent you allow this, finitary disjunctions and existential quantification. And finally, we arrive at geometric logic.
Maybe you should add the false, a symbol for false.
But it is. I didn't mention because it is an empty disjunction.
So it's not the symbol is not the binary disjunction.
No, this is a arbitrary finite disjunction, including false. Including false.
Okay.
Yeah.
And also the conjunction is finite. Or
not? Finite. It's not binary. Finite. Well. You can say binary plus false to take into consideration the empty case as well. Okay, geometric theories is, as we already said, you require these two formulas to be geometric, so these are built from atomic formulas by only using finitary conjunctions, possibly infinitary disjunctions, and existential quantification, and of course also the other proofs. Okay, so these are the main fragments of logic that you might want to consider, and of course we have to, now that we have defined the notion of theory, we are still at the syntactic level, so we should talk about probability in a certain theory. What does it mean? Because of course a theory is not a static object. A theory is meant to be just the beginning of a mathematical activity. So you have these sequences that you start with are called axioms. These are called the axioms of the theory. And what you are supposed to do is, starting from the axioms, to deduce other sequence from these axioms. And the way you do this is governed by what is called deduction systems. So you have deduction systems. And now here, I have waited until... after writing these different fragments, before introducing deduction systems, because of course each fragment has its own deduction system, and these deduction systems are not the same, even though there is a compatibility given by the fact that, now I don't have the time to write the details of this deduction system, they are just rules that are quite intuitive, for instance. Just to give you an idea, you have the rules of this kind. So this is what is called the cut rule, or you have the rule for finite conjunctions. Things like this.
This is Gelson type.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. So you have inference rules, so this means that from this you can deduce that, okay, when I put this line. And if you put a double line, it means that you can also go in the other direction. So you have deduction systems for each of these fragments of logic that I have introduced here. But as I was saying, there are compatibilities between them, because of course, imagine that you have a regular theory, for instance, and you want to consider it as a coherent theory. And then you have a notion of probability here and a notion of probability there, and for regular sequence. And so you wonder if they are the same. Yes, the answer is they are the same. It's easy to see. We shall briefly see it as a simple application of the double construction of the classifying topos that this gives naturally arise to. Anyway, so we have a notion of probability inside a theory. So we can probability of sequence. So we say that a certain sequence is provable in a given theory if there exists a derivation. A derivation is just, the idea that you can have of a formal proof. I mean, you apply these inference rules and axioms, and what you get at the end as conclusion, you can call it a theorem inside your theory. Okay, so now we have talked about this. Let me check, I'm not forgetting anything. Okay. Yes, exactly, yes. I mean, when you work in regular logic, you only talk about regular sequence, which means sequence of this form. When you work in geometric logic, you only consider that. Yes. Yes, I mean, all the rules that you could intuitively come up with, there are. There is an important exception, that is the rule of excluded middle. You don't... Yes, but they are presented in a slightly different way since we are presenting them in terms of sequence. So they might not be recognizable easily. Really, the treatment via sequence is... they are presented in this way. So I give references to that in the program, so you can have a look. Oh, that's a very good question. That's a very good question. So, Gödel's completeness theorem is something that refers to the set-based models of a certain theory. Now, and it requires the axiom of choice. Here, we have a great advantage over Gödel, which is the fact that we can consider models of our theories not just in sets, but in arbitrary categories, provided that these categories possess enough categorical structure for us to interpret all the connectives and quantifiers that arise in our fragment. This allows us to prove a strong completeness result, which is even stronger than Gödel's result, in a fully constructive way through the notion of syntactic category that I'm going to introduce. Because the notion of syntactic category, well, now maybe it is a bit premature to talk about this because I haven't even introduced the categorical semantics, but suppose that I have, then you... no, because otherwise I don't answer the question. But suppose that you can interpret theories in a certain category with an appropriate structure. Then the notion of syntactic category is very nice because it allows you to build a universal model of your theory inside this syntactic category, which we can denote like that. So we will have a universal model. What do I mean by universal? Well, it is universal in many senses. First of all, it is universal because, as we shall see, you will be able to obtain all the other models of the theory by pulling back this along certain functors. But from the point of view of completeness, it is important because this model satisfies the property that whatever is valid here is provable in the theory. And so it is a model that by itself realizes completeness. And this model is constructed in a completely, say, tautological way, like the Lindenbaum-Tarski algebra of a propositional theory.
You see, when you have a propositional theory, you can take the algebra consisting of the equivalence classes of propositional formulas over its language and so on, and this contains a model of the theory in which what is valid is precisely what is provable in the theory. And so this realizes completeness. And you see the difference between what you have in Gödel's framework, because in Gödel's framework you have to take all the set-based models of the theory, and moreover you have to suppose the axiom of choice. Here we allow ourselves to consider models in arbitrary categories, in particular in this syntactic category where we find this model, and then this is the model in which the syntax and semantics of the theory meet. And thanks to this meeting, to this unification, you can get back to probability in the theory. This is one of the main advantages of functorial semantics. It is a perfect illustration of the fact that looking at what happens just in sets is very limited because you don't get a faithful image of the theory. Even you see it. For finitary theories, you need the axiom of choice, and with the axiom of choice, you can do it. But imagine if you have an infinitary theory, then even the axiom of choice will not suffice to reconstruct the theory from its set-based models. You will, you are lost. If you want to study infinitary theories with the classical techniques in model theory, you are really lost. While here, even for infinitary theories, such as geometric theories, you have these things. This is called the strong completeness, because it is not just completeness, but it is something more, because everything is concentrated in a single model. Okay, so now the formal definitions. So what is... given a first-order signature sigma, what we can do is to consider the notion of a sigma structure in a category with finite products. No, you need just the finite products, because the only thing you need is to be able to take these finite products. Yeah. If you want to interpret Cartesian logic that we shall, I can define it now because we have talked about, so let me just define it for later. This will be useful not today, but tomorrow. So Cartesian, so what is a Cartesian theory? So a Cartesian theory, here you require these formulas to be Cartesian, but relative to the theory. So here one is really to refer to the notion of probability inside the theory. It means that a formula is Cartesian if it is built from atomic formulas by only using finitary conjunctions and existential quantifications which are provably unique in the theory. This is the logic of Cartesian categories, in the sense that if you take a Cartesian theory, then its Cartesian syntactic category will be Cartesian, and conversely, any Cartesian category can be seen as the syntactic category of such a theory. So this is finite limits. This is the terminology that you used yourself in your course. otherwise you can say finitely complete. That's the other. But I think we use Cartesian. That's the standard terminology. Okay, so suppose that we have a category with finite products C, and we want to define an interpretation for all the syntactic gadgets that we have introduced. So we have to interpret the sorts, function symbols, and relation symbols. Now, sorts, we interpret them as objects of our category C. Function symbols, we interpret them as arrows. So suppose we have a function symbol like that. This is going to be, it's better to use, okay. This is going to be interpreted as an arrow going from this finite product to MB. This is noted. Okay. This generalizes what happens in the classical Tarskian semantics. In the classical Tarskian semantics, sorts are interpreted as sets, and here we replace sets with objects because we are going. So in the classical case, C is equal to set, right? The category of sets and functions between them. Relation symbols will be interpreted as subobjects, equivalence classes of monomorphisms in our category C. No, I mean just monomorphism. So, yeah. So this will be a monomorphism like that. Constants will be interpreted as zero ary function symbols. So here I will have an empty product, and I will need to take the terminal object of the category. So n equals zero, so constants. So this will be like that. Okay. So we know how to interpret all of this. You see, everything goes very smoothly it is a very smooth generalization from what happens in sets to what you can do in an arbitrary category with finite products. But here, notice that we have just interpreted the very, very basic things, because we have just interpreted sorts, function symbols, and relation symbols. Of course, in general, if you want to go on and interpret complicated formulas, we need to require some categorical structure present on C in order to be able to do this. Because suppose, for instance, that you want to interpret a conjunction of two formulas. Well, here, finite products in general will not suffice anymore, because I would like to take the intersection of the interpretation of this with the interpretation of that. And such intersections, formally, they are pullbacks in a category. And so finite products will not in general suffice, and you will have to require at least the fact that the category is Cartesian. And of course, the more complicated the formulas are, for instance, you can you might want to interpret things like this with a lot of quantifiers. And this also is possible to do, in particular in every topos, you can interpret these things. But then you need to use a particular structure in your category to be able to do this. You cannot do it in every category. And as we shall see, each of these fragments has a corresponding class of categories in which it can be interpreted. But let's go with order. Okay, so once we have defined these interpretations of these basic ingredients, we describe how to interpret. Before talking about formulas, we have to talk about terms. How to interpret the terms? Well, this is completely straightforward, because you see, function symbols are interpreted in this way. Terms are just things that you start with variables, function symbols applied to them, and so it is completely clear how you interpret them. They will be as arrows. They will be interpreted as arrows, the terms. And this, you don't need anything more than finite products to do this. Instead, if you want to interpret atomic formulas, no, this only if it is a constant. If it is a variable, it will be a projection or just the identity of, it depends, if the context is larger, it will be a projection, otherwise it will be just the identity. So, terms we know how to do. Now, consider, for instance, these formulas. of this form. Imagine, for instance, that you want to interpret a formula of this kind, or a formula more generally, you might want to interpret a formula of this kind. You necessarily need more than finite products. Take, for instance, this formula. Then you will have that the interpretation of these two terms, this will be two arrows towards a certain thing, and the interpretation of this will be the equalizer of these two arrows. So you again, you need that your category possesses these equalizers, and here you will need the pullbacks in order to you will make a pullback where you consider the interpretation of R, which is a subobject, and then these terms will give you an arrow, and then you will form a pullback, and this will be the interpretation of your formula. Now, after you have clarified how to interpret atomic formulas, all the others are formed from them by using these logical connectives. Or quantifiers. And how to do this? Well, let's start. So, algebraic theories, you don't need anything more than finite limits. So, here I can, okay, I leave like that. So this means, here I take just well, actually just already finite products suffice, because all the axioms are of this form. So here you just need the categories with finite products. Here, suppose that you want to interpret both finite array conjunctions and existential quantifications. So for sure, finite conjunctions, you need to be able to take pullbacks. And you also need a terminal object. So it means that you need a Cartesian category. But it doesn't suffice, because in a Cartesian category, you might not have the possibility of interpreting these existential quantifications in a meaningful way. Now, you realize when you wonder about how to interpret this, you just try to reinterpret categorically what is the interpretation, the set theoretic interpretation of an existential quantification. And so, for instance, what you consider is when you have an arrow, or just a function, and when you consider its image, this André has talked about that in his course, this operation is very important. This operation of factorizing this as image, as a subjection followed by a monomorphism, because it is the key to know how to interpret this existential quantifier. Because if you look at how this is defined, you see that there is a sort of existential quantification here. So there is an element such that, you see, like that. It is the set of elements such that there exists something which is sent by F to it. Here you need the notion of regular categories. So regular categories are categories which are Cartesian, and in which, moreover, every arrow has a factorization, as an image. The image in general is characterized as the least subobject for which the arrow factors, and you require, moreover, these images to be stable under pullback. The stability under pullback is related to the fact that in your fragment of logic you want the substitution rule to be sound, and therefore you need also this pullback stability condition. Now, for coherent theories, you need more, because you see you have this thing here, and so you need what is called the coherent categories.
Now, coherent categories are regular categories in which, moreover, you have finite unions of subobjects, and these finite unions are again stable under pullback. Why? Because if I want to interpret a disjunction, how do I do? Well, suppose I know how to interpret, I have a disjunction like this, a finite disjunction, because here we are in coherent logic, and I know that the interpretation of each formula will be a subobject of my finite product like that. So all of these will be subobjects, you see? And how would you interpret the disjunction of this? Well, you would take the union of these subobjects. But again, this is something that you can always make in set, but not generally in an arbitrary category. So you need to impose the existence of these unions, these finite unions of subobjects, and you, moreover, have to require them to be stable under pullback, and this gives the notion of coherent category. Now, the infinitary notion of that is the notion of geometric category. And what is particularly important for us is that Groth and Dick toposes are geometric categories. And so we shall be able to interpret any kind of geometric theory in them. So I have 10 minutes before. Okay, excellent. Okay, so now. Well, if you want, no, here you don't get any negation, you just have the false. And the in what? Incoherent, no, you don't get a negation, but I mean, what you can get in coherent theory is the following thing. You can write things like this. Something entails false. This you can write. But this is the only kind of negation that you can write. You cannot write something complicated, more complicated. Okay, now. Yeah. Sequence, you mean? No, it works. The only problem is the intuitionistic or classical nature of your system, because the usual systems for first order logic, they are classical. So they have the law of excluded middle, and this is the only thing that that doesn't work. So this law here, it doesn't work in an arbitrary topos, or in an arbitrary category in general. Because this, in order for this to be true, well, this means that the interpretation of this is a complemented subobject. And in general, you don't have, even in a knighting category, which is what you would need to interpret all these negations and implications in a meaningful way, in a knighting category, unless this category is Boolean, and you can have Boolean categories, but they are not very frequent. And in particular, the majority of toposes are not Boolean. So if you want to interpret this in arbitrary toposes, you don't want the law of excluded middle.
Maybe it could be useful to explain how you can introduce, for example, a different symbol. X is different than Y.
Ah, yes. Yeah, this is, no, thanks for this suggestion. This is sort of what I suggested to do earlier when a person asked me what can I do if I want to introduce just one particular negation. For instance, I might want to introduce the negation of equality. So if I want to introduce this, I can do it while remaining inside coherent logic. The way I do is simply that I call this, let's call it N for negation of equality. So this will be a binary relation symbol. And what I will be able to do is to put axioms which ensure that this will be the negation, but the negation in the sense of a real complement of the diagonal, which is the interpretation. Yeah, of course. This is just that.
And the other one is the when you take the intersection of the two, you should get false. So you see, these are completely coherent axioms, because here I have, you see, a disjunction, here I have the false, and this is coherent, so we are in coherent logic, and this is an operation that we are going to talk about it later, so it's good that you asked me to anticipate, because tomorrow this will play a role, because it is a very natural thing to do when you have a theory to uninjectify it, in the sense that you want the category of models to remain the same, except for the fact that you want the arrows to become monomorphisms. And this is the way to do. If you add to the signature of your theory this thing, then automatically you will get, in terms of set-based models, the models will be the same, but the arrows will become the injective homomorphisms for your theory. And so,
it's possible to negate one specific
condition. Of course, without, yeah, of course, of course. You can always do. What I said before concerning the, what I said earlier concerning the more liaisation is a general procedure that doesn't look the theory specifically in face. I mean, it works for any theory in a blind way. And so, of course, you don't look, in most situations, you do this way. I mean, you just take a specific formula that you see that it's not geometric, you try to make it geometric through coherent axioms of this form. That's what you do. And of course, here we have seen an illustration of this in the case of negation, but you can see, the implication, it is more general than that, because the negation can be seen as implication to false, and you can make the same trick as well for the implication. So in particular situations, you just do this in order to get a geometric theory. You don't need to apply this very heavy machinery of more liaisation. Okay, how much? Okay, 4 minutes, okay. Now, what do I cancel? Okay, so what should I say now? Well, I would like just to conclude this first part by talking about soundness and completeness. I have already alluded to completeness earlier, but okay, yes, okay, I need to, no, there was something missing actually, okay. We have said what it is, a structure, a sigma structure in a category with finite products. Of course, we are now ready to say what it is, a model of a theory. Well, I haven't defined the homomorphisms of structures, but this is completely straightforward. I mean, a structure homomorphism is something that has the natural behavior with respect to both function symbols and relation symbols. So you can write, this is straightforward, you can write the definition yourself, and it doesn't present any surprise. So I can skip this, and instead I should certainly give the definition of model of a theory. So you have a theory T over a certain signature, and suppose that in a fragment, that the theory is in a fragment that is interpretable. Interpretable, I mean that it has enough categorical structure for one to interpret these things. Suppose that this theory is in a fragment that is interpretable in a certain category C, then one says that a sigma structure M is a model of T if all the axioms of T, all the axioms are of T, which are sequence of this form, so this will be things of this kind, are satisfied
in M. What does it mean, satisfied in M? It means that the interpretation of the antecedent is contained as a subobject into the interpretation of the conclusion. This is clear because remember that the intended meaning of a sequence was that for all x, phi entails this. So this is the same thing as saying that whatever element, let's say, that is in this interpretation is also in this interpretation. So now we know what a model of a theory is, and by considering the category whose objects are you are right to make this remark, but it suffices to check the axioms because we have a soundness, and I am about to talk about soundness. So, soundness and completeness. Yeah. No, fragment is just a part of the logic in which you make the choice of restricting your attention to certain particular classes of formulas.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's just, it means that you choose to consider just some, No, axiom is just when you define a theory, you say a theory is a set of sequence. These sequences are called the axioms of the theory, by definition, yeah. You don't have anything. No. I mean, it can be whatever. A theory is really a presentation. So whatever way you have to present, and just a list of sequence that you call axioms. No, not at all. No. Otherwise, it could even be a proper class. So, no, it is a set of sequence. And then there is this very important... Now, just notation. Notation is this. T mod T. This is the notation for the category whose objects are the models of T inside the category C. And the arrows are the... structure homomorphisms. So the notion of morphism here at the level of models or the notion of morphism at the level of structure is exactly the same. So you define the category of structures, and this is a full subcategory. Okay, this is just for notation. Now, soundness and completeness is precisely what answers the question. Soundness means that any sequence which is provable in T is valid in all models of T in categories. Here I put categories of the appropriate kind, relative to the fragment, of course, of the appropriate kind. Now, as you can imagine, this is a theorem that is very easy to prove because the only thing is quite straightforward. The only thing you have to check is whenever you have an inference rule, if the premise is satisfied, then also the No, valid, it means that the interpretation of the antecedent is contained into the... This is the notion of validity in general. Okay, and completeness is... I just write the converse. I mean, if a sequence is valid in all the models of the theory in categories of the appropriate kind, then it is provable in the theory. And... I have already remarked that here we don't just have completeness, but we have strong completeness, thanks to the existence of syntactic categories. But this will be for after the break.